Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Well, it is a blessing to be back in the abiding place in San Diego. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Yikaranai. Hallelujah. Kataya la makuru saparati frabaya. Ha ha ha. O ramane. O saramen liksham le prevoya. Ayetakaya ramonjaya. Ha ha ha. Keti rababadeo. Keribadeo lobo. Kera sherana mambe remanini. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You can be seated for a little while. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. You know, I just want to speak to you just a little while here tonight, and hopes that you would allow, you will give permission to God to let His glory flow out of you. I was so blessed the other night as I was watching some people who didn't know how to flow in the Holy Ghost become so overwhelmed with God. They were just captured away. They were just lost away, walking around prophesying, telling people about what was going on in their life. It was beautiful. People never had operated in the gifts of the Spirit, had discovered that the Lord had not come to put a yoke of religious activity upon us, an obligation, but it actually come to liberate us so we could just flow. Hallelujah. 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 I'm in expectation tonight that every person in this place will hear the announcement of the good news, that you get to be liberated now to live a heavenly life. So what we've watched over and again is how the people, they hear wrong, they hear the word of God that goes forth, and then they mix it with all kinds of ideas and religious precepts and whatnot, and it turns out to be something different than what the Lord said. And what Father has done is He's actually given us the privilege now to live a life that is in the realms called heaven, and somehow people begin to come under the yoke of obligation rather than the wonderful yoke of release or the liberty wherewith Christ has set us free. And you know, tonight, if you just let the Spirit of the Lord touch you, in a way that only He can touch you, if you just won't hold on to yourself and you go ahead and lose your life tonight, you can understand that it's not so much the way that you are constantly saying no to the wrong things and resisting the wrong things and trying to live a life to where that, you know, you're just doing those things which please the Father, but rather you're now being filled with all the good things and you're being overwhelmed with all the heavenly things. And so now being good, filled with all the good things and overwhelmed with all the heavenly things, you're no longer interfacing with all the problems and all of the issues. Because I'll just tell you right now, if you haven't discovered it yet, that's a losing battle for you. You know, you're just trying so hard. You know, my Uncle Charles wrote the song, Trying So Hard to Tame This Beast So Wild. Hallelujah. I mean, you know, what a terrible life of bondage. What a terrible life of imprisonment. What a terrible life of religion. I really I break it down like this. You're either living a life of religion or you're living a life in the Holy Ghost, living in life flowing in the things, hallelujah, that are heavenly. And listen to me. We don't worship God on the basis of who we are. We worship God on the basis of who He is. And I watch people all the time. They're going to worship God on the basis of who they are. Somebody said, that is ridiculous. How could that be? Oh, yeah. They describe, based on how they feel or what they're thinking or how things going in their life, then they worship God. Or if they're suddenly overwhelmed with a feeling, then they worship God. That isn't the way it's supposed to be going down. We're not supposed to be worshiping God on the basis of what we've of who we are. In other words, of how we feel and what we think, and that which is, you know, really totally in the dimensions of a self realm. But we're supposed to be worshiping Him on the basis of who He is, and thus we now are freed and liberated from all the issues that we might be carrying around and all the things that we might be feeling. Ah, Bosakai, Aranashaya. If you will begin to do these things, you will be liberated. Hallelujah. Well, you'll begin to at least enjoy the liberation, because I think that many people have been liberated, but they sit around the prison of captivity thinking about entering back in to that realm. They don't know how to walk around in this place of divine glory. So I'm going to minister to you tonight for the purpose of you being able to step into a glorious liberty and a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ in a dimension that you haven't known up to this moment in time. A big part of being able to move forward in God is coming into a place with a great expectation. So I've purposed to go after the things of the Spirit beyond anything that I've known. Many people come with a common, ordinary, you know, expectation. Maybe people don't even come with an expectation. They just come, you know, with just they show up. And Father has all of His fullness available to us, and hunger and thirst. Hey, listen, hunger and thirst causes you to step up to the table. You know, I never seen anybody hungry and thirsty hanging out in the living room. I just haven't seen it. I haven't seen anybody hungry and thirsty show up to the house just say, you know, well, you know, I just don't want to impose on anybody, you know, and I feel like that I just need to sit over here and just be quiet and after all. No, you in the kitchen snipping around saying, when are we going to eat now? Okay, we're in need. And we pray in Jesus' name. Now, if you have stepped into all the fullness of the Father and you operating in all the greater works, I could understand why you might not be too hungry tonight, because you over there. But otherwise, people should be passionate. Too many people are willing to allow things to be as they are. They're willing to just accommodate sickness. They're willing to accommodate disease. They're willing to accommodate sin. They're willing to accommodate a status quo within the framework of Christianity. They're willing to go without the move of God. They just stand there and feel sad about their situation. Rather than allowing that, the Holy Spirit who supplies hunger to turn into a realm of passion to where that you're just not going to let up. You relentlessly are going out to the things of the Spirit. You know, I love going out and doing the things that we just got finished doing in Zambia. Because I find out how Father just so easily come to people who have never really encountered Him, and how they're just overwhelmed, and they're just taken captive by the Holy Ghost. To then come to understand that even those people, like for example, many of you tonight here in this place, you've had the same similar experiences in God, but you didn't allow that to go to a place where that you continued in a relentless pursuit of God. You kind of just settle out. You just kind of accept it. You just, you know, you don't go into the press and go after more. And because Father is there to fill you up with every good thing, but He demands something of us. He demands hunger and thirst of us. He demands a passionate desire. He demands something within us that we will. See, we just believe that He's here to fill us with all the fullness of those things which He has. He's here to give to us that wonderful realm of interaction with Him where we begin to experience all the spiritual blessings which we're blessed with. And because we so believe that, because we are so persuaded of it, thus we don't live without it. Oh, I'm on you. Can you feel I'm on you? Can you feel I'm down in the middle of your stuff right now? Of the things that you compromised with, is all they compromise with the world. Well, how you compromise with you? How about you stop compromising? Because compromising and comparison and competition is demonic. It belongs to a demonic realm. It has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. Listen, when you read the Word of God and you recognize that all that's for you, and you're going to sit there all sad and somber looking, you got yourself a problem. And I'm here tonight to break you out of the problem, because you're never going to shine with, I mean, I'm telling you right now, Bob Marley's got more joy than, you know, had more than most of the people who's supposed to be filled with the Holy Ghost. I mean, come on. I'm telling you right now, Bob Marley's encounter with demon spirits that allowed him to do what he did isn't going to outshow me for a second. I'm going to lay hold on the things that God has given in his divine power and glory. Come on now, people. I let the Baptists slide this past couple of weeks. Well, I let them slide. The Lord didn't let them slide. They slid right down onto the ground. They couldn't stand up. They melted. I watched them melting in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. I mean, I'm sure that Phil had all kinds of complaints after the first day, after the first two meetings I preached. And then, you know, we were only supposed to minister like three nights and then minister to the day, to the advanced mission training people. But what happened is ended up ministering every night. And then, you know, on the seventh night, Phil was talking about it going on for 8 weeks. I didn't feel we could be away that long. Hallelujah. But, you know, just seeing God's people catch the fire of his presence and harobo derede. You know, Phil sent me a message this morning, said, I'm telling you, man, everybody's standing around glowing over here. And I'm thinking, oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, 2 weeks with them, they're glowing. You know, I pray to, oh, God, Jesus' name, that the people over there at the abiding place would start glowing. You've glowed. You've had many glowing opportunities. But what happens is you settle out for stuff, huh? You're not selling that for nothing. I'm telling you, I can see that on you. They grow weary of whatever it was that they were trying to do. Me, I found that every time you seek God, he answers. I found that every time you begin to worship him, you passionately pursue him, you have answers. Hallelujah. Not more questions, more answers. Hallelujah. Not less strength, more strength. Hallelujah. 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 We had this one couple, and they sat on the front row, and bless their darling hearts, and they've been in ministry for many, many, many centuries. It's been many, many, many years, and they had recently come take a position in mission field in Zambia, and they were just sitting there. You know, they had that particular religious look, something like that. You know, it's like it's this weird stare and glare. You know, and you know, I just kind of ignored them. I ignored them for about 4 days. They were melting in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah! They just melting, and it could kazika hagina gigataha. It's a beautiful thing. They had to show up to all the meetings. And, you know, for those first couple of days, we were doing three meetings a day. And the Spirit of the Lord just told me to go and talk about the Holy Ghost. And, you know, when we're doing meetings like that, many times the hardest hearts will melt. And, of course, we've been pursuing an anointing in God that doesn't matter how stubborn people are, how arrogant they are, how religious they are, how defiant they are. It doesn't matter. That it's going to, whatever's going on in their life is going to melt. Yeah. They're not going to affect me. I'm going to affect them. Hallelujah. And so it was so beautiful. It was so beautiful because they both got baptized in the Holy Ghost. Fresh baptism in the Holy Ghost by the fifth or sixth of the day. Both baptized and then fired the Holy Ghost. The wife had been in pain for over 20 years, completely, totally healed. Hallelujah. Wow. Hallelujah. And the husband comes and he's, you know, he repents. He said, I just want to repent. He said, there was a time in my life where I used to function, operate in the gifts of the Spirit, and I backed away. And I said, right now in the name of Jesus, be filled. Just right there. I said, right now in the name of Jesus, be filled. And it was a beautiful thing. He became so caught away. He was like those on the day of Pentecost. He lost all thought and concept of where he was. He actually thought he was in charge of the meeting. He took over the meeting. He was just totally drunk. He was just absolutely beside himself. We say drunk because he was beside himself. He stepped into a place of being liberated. See, you have an opportunity to live the greatest, most awesome, most liberated life, amazing life. And you're holding on to yourself and you're going to have to let go. You're trying way too hard. You're trying way too hard. It's got too much self-motivation and self-interest all entangled in it. God doesn't want us trying so hard. He simply wants us to hunger and thirst after Him, after that which He can do. And He comes and He rabosete mun zizaya, furataya, supplies with this. Hurabake shilato yadamaseteya. Hallelujah. 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 Just eridaya. Hallelujah. Halanaze. Just say remane keo. Hamane sheya to ya. Ha ha. Hale kede ne jesisu. Hambom de le. Hale mum brazea. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I want you to open your Bibles tonight to John chapter 12 and verse 43. And let me just minister to you a while concerning this wonderful liberation that God the Holy Ghost has for you. And I pray that you won't just be hearers of the word tonight, but that you'll be doers, that you'll go ahead and just do this. And I pray that you won't look to yourself. Tonight, if you look to yourself, you are going to become more and more miserable as the night goes on. If as I minister, you begin to look to your own strength, your own ability, and what you can do, you're going to become more intensely upset and less yielded to God the Holy Ghost. But as we begin to speak to you these wonderful things concerning this life in God, and you begin to turn your heart into to the Father and say, Lord, I want that. Mama, let's take care of you. I tell you, man, after what Father, I mean, we've had some wonderful things happen and go down in our lives. But after what Father's like did over this past 2 weeks, we're just watching what took place in people's lives. I just said, Lord, you really need me out there. I am extremely needed. There are people are running around living a dual life and just you're trying so hard to do what you want and having so much fun with the devil. Just so trying so hard to be your servants and just being captivated with the sin and iniquity and pleasures of this world. Father, your people need somebody to show them what it looks like to live in the glorious liberty. Hallelujah. To go and minister these wonderful things concerning this wonderful life that you've given. So God, Father has given us His life, the life of God. Can you just think about that with me for a minute? That again, if you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and you've been born of the Spirit, you've been giving the life of God. You talk about liberating, and yet people want to go and just live their own life. They want to live it on the basis of what they can do, and they nurture their out of their own realms of their own human ability and effort. I mean, they probably nurture that the majority of time, maybe 90% of the time, maybe even 99% of the time, people are nurturing absolutely the wrong thing. They're nurturing their own self-interest, their own strength, their own human effort, their own human ability. I mean, many meetings in the church centered around people singing songs that are inspired in an entirely different realm than that which God has purposed them to be inspired. I mean, no worship leaders supposedly are ever going to be able to empower you to worship. Only the Holy Spirit is. You're going to have to learn how to be empowered by the living God. Hey, just bring him here. Just bring him here. You can actually take care of your kids a lot better if you just pray in the Holy Ghost. I know that they get a little bit, overactive sitting there. And if you just don't be stressed out. You need to flow in the things of the Spirit. And, this morning, I watched people, power of God was greatly revealed in this place. I watched people leave without a flow of the Holy Ghost in their life. It's so sad that you would be willing to come to church and leave with you. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Do you understand what I'm saying? Oh, somebody said, well, I just want God. No, when you want him, you get him. Anybody who's thirsty gets to drink. Anybody who's hungry gets to eat. I mean, there's too many people wanting things to be, they want things to be given to them by means of on the level of what they define. God's given you the privilege to be totally liberated from the life that you would live, and with total abandonment, just let go of everything and begin to serve him. Because now you're going to get to live a life. It is a kind and quality of a life that will last forever. That's how wonderful of a life it is. It is the kind and quality of a life that will represent the living God. Father's purpose it to fully represent him. You have an opportunity. But you know what? If you're not careful, every day in the Western world, you will begin to build a prison for yourself. Every day, you'll build that prison. You'll create debt for yourself. You'll create, not only debt, but dependency upon the paycheck, dependency upon the value that men give you. The Lord wants to liberate you. And you can, it can happen right now. You can say, well, you know, Pastor, listen, I'm so far in debt. There's no way out. Oh, yeah, there is a way out. It's called just jumping in over here in the realms of faith, and Father will empower you. He'll take better care of you than you could ever take care of yourself. You created a prison for you. Jesus Christ comes and says, I open up the prison doors. I set you free. And then if you're not careful, you're just going to stand in there in the prison with the door open. And every once in a while, when no one's looking, you're going to walk out and go, woo, wow, this is great. And then some people are going to be looking at you again, and you'll feel all insecure. And then you're going to go back in your prison where you feel all secure and look at everyone through the bars. Some people think, I don't know what I'm talking about. I know exactly what I'm talking about. That they're just waiting for God to speak. He's already begun. They're waiting for something that is specific to them. This is. Thank you, Jesus. What's going to make the difference? You quitting your job tomorrow? No. You deciding tonight that all you want is the things of heaven. And you decide on a level that you now are unwilling to live without them. Now your prayers aren't little prayers, little whispered prayers. Now your position isn't something that looks, you know, like a person who asks for something. I look on people's face and I see this. It's like that they ask God for something and he said no. I'm kidding you. It's the same look I've watched my kids have when they ask for something. I said, you can't have that. Same disappointed look. The Lord's never said no. And if you could believe that tonight, if you're willing to believe that. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the shield of faith here in just a little bit. I want to set a foundation. I want to talk to you about the means by which you can begin to deal with those harassing, tormenting things that causes you to act and behave as though those things that God has said is not for you or relevant to you right now. Maybe, I know how it is. People will make the power of God relevant to them in the future. Oh, tomorrow. Oh, someday. A someday relationship with God. So, oh, yes, in the future. Praise God. No. Right now, tonight. Father would empower you. And I'm telling you right now, when you get empowered by God, when you allow God to begin to move in your life, to speak to your life, suddenly all of those things that seem to be inaccessible to you are immediately, instantly yours. You know, I like to tell people, I like to emphasize the point of how natural it is to flow in the realms of heaven in the gifts of the Spirit. I don't usually, in the School of Spirit, which we will have this Friday night, I don't really usually talk so much about the details of what it looks like to flow in the gifts of the Spirit, or how to flow in the gifts of the Spirit, because I believe that's as natural as walking and breathing for those people who are born of God. I talk to them about the things that are stopping them, because the things that you're buying into that are hindering you, that are holding you back. Tonight we just want you to be liberated. Tonight we want you with total abandonment to be as though this is the first time you've ever come to Jesus. We want, some of you just need, we need to help you get past the influence of your hormones. Some of you, we need to get help you get past the influence of your endocrine system. You're tired all the time. We want you to get healed. Some of you, the best of what you have, you give to your recreation. Or you, the best of what you have, you give to your workplace. That's the best, and then whatever's left over, you're just like, you know, burned out like a sheet with two burned out holes in it, you know. I've been used up by the world system. I've been used up by the cares of this life. I have nothing left for the Lord. I've been used up by the deceitfulness of riches. I've been used up by a lust for other things. And I want to just grab a hold of this. I want you to grab a hold of this reality of Father's passion to produce within you a certain fruit that He's cultivating, that He's so desperate for, that He bore our sins on in His own body on the tree. There's something that Father so wants manifested in our life that He gave all that He has to reproduce it within us. Paul, yes, had a glorious experience on the road to Damascus. He saw Jesus. And this wonder, then this guy who was committed, so consecrated to his religion, suddenly was captivated by the wonderful presence of Jesus. But then there was an event that happened that was even greater in impact in his life. Because he discovered, he had a revelation that Father wanted to reveal His Son in him. That Father wanted to reveal Christ Jesus in him. That Jesus died and rose again and ascended up on high for the purpose of all of His glory in person being revealed and lived out, made manifested through our own lives. When you begin to understand and contemplate that this is the passion of the living God, how could we not have an? How could we say that we hungry and thirsty to do the will of the Father? And not be captivated with the same passion that His manifest and expressed will has displayed over and over again, even from the very beginning when He created Adam and shaped in His own image and likeness and set all the works of His hand underneath His feet and brought all creation, as it were, to Him and to see what He would call them, what He would name it. And here Christ Jesus has brought forth this wonderful place for us to live in. And we want to live in, we want to live under the influences of the powers of darkness that will fight and do whatever they've got to do, listen to me, to stop the power and the glory of the living God from being manifested to our lives. They would try to do whatever they're going to do, whatever it takes, whatever way they can influence, whatever way they can affect you and me, they're going to do it to stop Christ Jesus from being manifested and revealed in our life. But tonight I want to say to you, as many as you've received Christ Jesus, walk ye in Him. As many of you who have been born of the Spirit, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I tell you right now, it is by the putting on of the Lord Jesus Christ that you make no provision for these other things. In other words, there's no opportunity, in other words. There's no way. You don't have to live this life of constantly trying to tame and the situation and constantly in a place where you in a battle and by your own human effort, human ability, trying to fend off the pleasures of this world and losing right, left, and center. But when we just filled up with the glory, oh, the sai and the mekishi, landambruga fagila, asadera diksta, tonight, let this song room, let this to remain me. Belengilalo pokada. Erestepeira. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Give the, just with total abandonment. Dive in. Quit holding on to yourself so tight. It looks ugly. It looks ridiculous. You sitting there hugging yourself like that. I mean, good. Hug somebody else instead of hugging yourself because that's weird. You know what I'm saying? Let go. Come on, get liberated tonight, man. Hallelujah. Get liberated tonight. Hallelujah. That Father's no respected persons. He touched you. It touched you. The only reason you don't get touched is because you're holding on so tightly to yourself. And, you know, there are things where I know, I've watched where people have been born into religion. And religion is a powerful, fortified force against the anointing of the Holy Ghost. It is. And, you know, we want to see God needs, desires, wants to have the glorious liberty of that which He spent so much on you and me. He poured out all the riches of heaven so that you and I could walk around in this divine power and in this divine glory and be witnesses of what it means to live out the heavenly life. Jesus says here in his sermon here in John chapter 12, hallelujah, Jesus says this. And now back up just a little bit. Verse 20, and there were certain Greeks among them that came to worship at the feast, and same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, desiring him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip then came, told Andrew, and Andrew came again, and Philip both teamed up together and came and told Jesus. And Jesus answered and said to them, The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Just so beautiful. He's saying, Father, glorify me with the glory which I had with you before anything existed. We read about what he's talking about. Chapter 17. He's looking beyond the cross. He's looking beyond the crucifixion. He's looking beyond the betrayal now. He's looking beyond the suffering. He's now seeing that place now. Hallelujah. And we in a place that you and I now possess in him. But you're going to have to move past your doubts and unbeliefs. You're going to have to move past your stuff. You're going to have to, listen, there are a lot of things that God is going to do in our lives simply as a direct result of obedience. It's not works, it's obedience. He comes to us with his love and he comes to us with his grace and he tells us what to do. And then we don't do it. He tells us sometimes very simple things. He tells us like go wash in the pool of Siloam. You know, he tells us very simple things. Go dip 7 times in the Jordan. He tells us really simple things, you know. That we just decide that, you know, that well, I don't have to listen to that. I don't believe that. I disagree. And it was all the time God, the Holy Ghost speaking. And then it was something so simple, that you can then not only be disobedient and not do it, and then self-justify, which is having your own righteousness. But then you don't even remember it because it was so simple and you were so easy for you to be disobedient with it. It doesn't even come to mind as you sit there struggling and as it were almost spiritually squirming, going, what's wrong with me? Why can't I step into this realm? Disobedience. God told you to do something, you wouldn't do it. God just made it out, laid it out there for you, and it was just too hard for you. And it could have been something so easy to do. And we say these things tonight not to cause you to look back, but cause you to become more sensitive for the now, right now. Because with God, he's a God of the second chance, third chance, 300 chance, 3,000, 30,000, 300,000. I mean, but you're going to run out of seconds of life. The only thing that's going to stop giving you an opportunity for another opportunity to obey God and to go with God is the fact that you're going to run out of breath. You're going to run out of time. You got a certain amount of time appointed unto you. I personally want to live glorious for the Lord. I would rather be in heaven. But the reality of it is, I can live in heaven right now, and I want to live fully for His glory. I don't want to say, well, you know, I'm going to die of some sickness and disease. It's as though I've seen people sell out and compromise. Oh, I'm going to die of some sickness and disease. You are. You're going to bring that kind of disgrace to His name. That's where your faith is hooked up, that you're just going to, just get diseased. I mean, why is it that people can't grab a hold of what it means and the responsibilities of what it means to live a disciplined life, committed to having those things which God has purposed for us to have, not instead of living a disciplined life, committed to the things that they purpose to have? Because one day, these things are going to be weighed in the balance for you and me, and the Lord's going to show us, look at how disciplined you were for the things you wanted to have. That was about your earthly existence. Now, look at how disciplined you were about the things I wanted you to have. It was about representing and glorifying me. I tell you, I want, when the scale is weighed, I want to hear a big slam, you know, and I want it to be a slam on the side of the scale. Look at the discipline that was in your life and the purpose to live out representing me in your spirit and in your body. Listen, that should give you a lot of purpose about how you take care of your body. Tonight, we're just bringing up some of these things just simply so that you can begin to understand that your behavior, that your responses to the anointing, that your responses to the word of the Lord is going to have a big impact on how easy it is for you to begin to step in to all the realms of divine glory. Once again, I love going to different places and watching people from different perspectives respond to the word of God. If they respond to the word of God, no matter how messed up they are, the anointing comes in and takes over. Whereas there's others who don't respond to the word of God. They just sit there thinking it through. Or maybe even participating with something that is so evil and so wicked that it grieves the Holy Spirit probably more than or just as bad as any other kind of iniquity, and that is to sit with criticism and comparisons. Oh, to just allow this love of God, to allow this glory of heaven to overwhelm our souls. And you know, I believe that one of the things that causes us to allow this glory and this love of God to overwhelm our souls is we become so hungry and passionate to have the things that He's purposed for us to have. To have this flow of heaven in our life. To have this, the one Bodhisattva, the wonderful manifestation of His only begotten Son revealed through our lives. This beautiful privilege of being heir with Him and co-inheritors with Him. We're just so captivated by all that heaven has for us that there's no way that all these other things even have a snowball's chance in hell of existing. Huh? Have a snowball's chance in the fire of God. Of even existing. Jesus says this. I want you to understand, Father is devoted to cultivating something in our lives. Father is devoted. He's a husbandman, and we're laborers together with the Lord of His husbandry and of His building. He's a husbandman. And Christ Jesus is the vine, and He's brought us forth out of the vine. We came forth out of the vine. We exist only in Him. As a branch comes forth out of the vine, first the vine comes up, and out of the vine begins to grow branches. And out of that branch, out of that vine, we came forth out of Father's husbandry, out of Father's care. Manzegena bokotaya. Lisfresitorto sundarefishi. Lokorosarra mokosikalane. Maklingnesi. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I'm telling you, Satan, you are going to stop running amok and fouling up the word of God in the minds of God's people. It's time. It's high time that you people in this place rise up to the life of Jesus Christ. You've been blessed with the glory realm in this place. You've been blessed with the realms of His anointing in this place, with realms of provision from heaven in this place. It's time now. It's high time now. You quit listening to the voices of hell. You quit being influenced by demon power. Decide once and for all that you're going to serve the living God, that He's for you, that everything that He has, He's given to you. He's made you an heir as much as He's made anybody else an heir. He's given you the opportunity. As much as He's made anyone else a co-inheritor, He's given you the opportunity. As much as He's given joy unspeakable and full of glory to anyone, He's given it to you. As much as He's given the privilege and the empowerment of all these things that the baptism of the Holy Ghost would express, it's yours. It's time you quit listening to the wrong voices. It's time you come under the rule. It's time you come under the rod with a greater consecration. People, I'm telling you right now, who wants a joy unspeakable and full of glory that just lasts while you're here in the meeting? Why not have enough move of God, you got joy unspeakable and full of glory when you wake up in the morning? when you face the oppositions of life. Hallelujah. You know, we watch as the power of God just touches people and heals them radically. It's almost a part, not even participating with their, it almost doesn't even have anything to do with their faith. And then we watch as now God wants your faith to be activated and you have to participate with it. I love what Sandy was sharing with me this morning. She came, she had a hernia, and the doctor said, you have to have surgery on this right away. And she came to the meeting last Sunday morning, and she gets prayed for, and half of it was gone. She went in the bathroom, filled. Geneva said, go check it out. Half of it was gone. Then that night, she came back, prayed again, and the other, about almost all the other half left, just a small of a little pea was all that was left. She's like, Lord, what's going on? Why is it that why? And she started getting desperate. Instead of just justifying the situation, saying God doesn't heal everybody, and whatever the things that is that people do, because they're not sold out on what God said in His Word. They're still mixing it up with their own ideas and the concepts of men. Listen, you cannot walk in the Lord Jesus Christ if you're spoiled by the traditions of men and philosophies of men. And that's Paul's warning. As many as you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, walk in Him. He understands it on a level that God had purposed to reveal His Son. That is God's plan. That is the actual, that is the result of having been born again. Here it is. God will now reveal His Son in you and me. If you've been born again, that's what's happened. That's God's plan. That's God's purpose. That you and I no longer live our own life, but we're constantly trying to bring our life to the table and negotiate with God. And He's not negotiating. Thus your prayers aren't answered. By and large, little spotty moves of God in your life. Just so that the Lord can encourage you that He still loves you. But sometime you're going to have to start being obedient. You're going to have to come under the rule. Oh, well, I'm going to come under the rule as soon as God shows up and I can see Him and I hear His audible voice tell me these various different things. No, you won't. You may for the first month, then it'll wear off. And so I said, how do you know that that's going to be that way? Because that's what Jesus said. You know, we get this same concept of this when we hear the Lord say concerning the man who went down into hell and said, raise someone up from the dead and send him back to my brothers. He said, if they won't hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they hear if someone's been raised from the dead. Jesus stood in front of all of these people who were supposedly so hungry for God, so desperate to do the will of God, and they wouldn't listen to Him. There's something about the heart that's got to be touched within the realms of men's lives. God wants to touch that. It isn't, listen to me, it isn't all of the things that we think is important to do to have Father begin to flow through our lives. It's a disposition of our heart and of our spirit to receive the things that He's saying. I've watched as, and as strange as it may sound, where people begin to pray for people and they're speaking in the tongues or the language of the spirit that they have received. And they're stuck in one little expression that really isn't in any way a full maturation of even that gift. And they're being just expressing that realm of what they believe is how they're going to get into the realms of receiving from the Lord. They're actually resist what God would bring to them. Is that wild? Does that seem somewhat paradoxical? It's really where people live. Because it's not just religion. It's actually comes down to the point of things getting so convoluted in your mind that you have to engage in the efforts of your own ability of what you think that you know and understand. And then that's what you're depending upon instead of just being liberated to throw wide open your heart and your spirit to the Lord and say, oh God, come and feel me. It isn't that hard, people. I'll tell you right now, let me just say this. If I was reaching out towards heaven to touch heaven, to be touched by heaven, and I didn't feel nothing, I'd do a swan dive into this carpet right here, so to speak. I wouldn't leave this building. If I couldn't touch heaven, I wouldn't leave this building. I'd be right here. Because I'm not going to be without that which Christ Jesus died for me to have. I've been persuaded. I'm not guessing. I'm not wondering. I'm not religious high-fiving, being willing to live without, being willing to compromise and sell out and accommodate to the things that would be imposed upon me by a world system or by demonic oppression. Or by traditions or philosophies. They spoil you. They'll mess you up just as bad. I hope you can hear me tonight. Do I need to be turned up? I'm asking the Lord. Last night, we didn't sleep 30 hours. We lost so much sleep. On the way back, I mean, we didn't close our eyes for 30 hours. I mean, by the time Elizabeth picked us up, we had been awake for 24 hours. I got a lot of work done. I've got a lot of Hebrew done. I read 2 books on the rise of the new empire in the Gulf, a forerunner of Babylon. Got writing done, but I didn't get any sleep. And on the way there, we were 42 hours in transit. And we caught a little sleep here and there. And then when we got there, we were awake for 24 hours, a little more. But God gives us the grace and He gives us the ability, because we don't even concern ourselves with that. We don't listen to all that men would say about what happens if you lose that kind of sleep. Nor do we let our bodies dictate to us what we're going to do, because our spirit's bigger than our bodies. Come on. Let me just say this. How many have ever woke up grumpy or sad, or just been grumpy or sad, and then you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost till the joy came? Well, that means you have power over your endocrine system. You have power over the natural functions of your body. That's a beginning point. So now you think you got the full-blown manifestation of the power of God? No, you just had a beginning point. Huh? Now you're going to be too lazy to go ahead and exercise that? Because it just costs too much? I'm going to have to step up for God and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost and touch heaven, and I'm just all worn out from my daily living to do that? I don't even have enough energy left to touch heaven. I gave it all to myself and to men. Come on now, I'm just helping you here. Because Father is cultivating a fruit. He wants to bring forth the precious fruit of the earth. He's sown the seed of His word into our life. We've been made a new creature, a new creation. Old things are passed away. We are a new man. We're not trying to be a new man. Come listen to me. The old man is crucified. Everything that belonged to the former existence has gone away. Everything about our life belongs to Jesus. And that's only going to be, that can only be revealed in the people's lives who've taken the realm of the Holy Ghost and function and flow in the realms of the Holy Ghost. Because you can talk about being a new man all you want. If you just live like an old man, who cares what it is you say? You don't know how to flow in the Holy Ghost. You don't know how to flow in the power of the new man. Are you listening to me? You're captivated by this self-interest. You know, I'm breaking you out of that prison tonight. I got the key. And then I'm going to crawl in there. I'm thinking about crawling in. Some of you crawling in that thing, that cell, and dragging some of you out. Because I unlocked the door a long time ago. And you're still pacing the thing. Are you listening to me? Tonight I would like to basically take a blowtorch from heaven and just completely cut up all the bars so that the prison doesn't even exist anymore. And you just go to stand in the spot if you feel uncomfortable. How is it that you can believe in God and believe in His salvation, which is defined in a new creation, defined in Christ Jesus being made manifest and revealed to your life, and sit around contemplating something less, and being willing to have something less, being willing to live something less? I want you to get rid of the strains of human effort. I want you to get rid of the expressions of being perplexed. Huh? Sometimes I start ministering, it looks like somebody's lifting 1,000 pounds. Instead of just the flow and the peace and the glory of God overwhelming your life. What's going on in your heart is being expressed on your face. You don't believe it, but God believes it. And I'm going to tell you right now, you may not believe it, but the world around you believes it. They look at your face and say, I see what's going on in your heart. And you believe it too, because as soon as your spouse starts looking as bad as some of you look in church sometimes, you'd be saying, what's wrong? Are you going to be okay? Do you need to go to the doctor? We told a bunch of people, we said you didn't carry revival compact mirrors around. Everyone who did had a breakthrough. Everyone who didn't, because that was just funny. Oh, it's so fun. Pastor's making a joke. No, pastor's not making a joke. He's just giving you a go dip in the Jordan 7 times. Thank you, Jesus. We love people who are quick to obey. It just takes what we're saying, which can be proven again and again in the word of the Lord. And there's sometimes we've told people to do things that you can't actually prove it in the Bible. We told them to do things out of the Spirit. There's people sitting in here tonight. We told you to do things, you never regarded them. We told you to do them more than once, you never regarded them. You said it was just a physical realm. You just limited it to a physical realm. You limited it to, oh, well, I disagree. You can disagree all you want, but you're going to miss out on the good stuff. Disagree all you want, but you're going to miss out. Then you're going to sit around and have a fasting and praying, saying, oh, God, why am I missing out? And you know what? You're not going to hear nothing. He's not going to even talk to you. He loves you, but he's not going to talk to you audibly because he's already got somebody talking to you, me. I'm talking to you. Geneva's been talking to you the past 2 weeks. Hallelujah. And everything's good. There's no problems in the atmosphere. That's how we know. We got to come in and like start blowing things up. It's like, what on earth's going on in here now? We gave the authority over to someone who does not know how to stand against the powers of darkness and deal with confusing, lying spirits who enter into the place. You got to understand that. Listen, we have what we have here because we are unwilling to have anything less. And we're desperate for more. Yes. Of the administration of the things of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. My wife, she's so amazing. She carries this. I said this many years ago. She carries it to this day. Randy went and made them up. She's desperate about function in the greater realm of the anointing. She's desperate about the fullness of the measure of the maturity, the ministry of Jesus in her life. Look at her struggle on her face. Just look at the intense concern that she might be left out. No, they that come without faith, it's impossible to please God. On the basis of the faith, the foundation of faith is a trust relationship. That he's called you and that he's leading you and that he's purposed to bless you with everything that he has. I mean, go read about Abraham, you're reading about what Father wants to do in your life. You're reading about his ways, who he is, what he will do for anybody who's willing to walk with him. And then he takes it to a supernatural level and calls that trust on a supernatural level faith. Hallelujah. And hoko shi namandeya prusta. And the only way you're going to get dombalaya, the only way you're going to begin to move in faith is with total abandonment. You're going to throw all yourself to the wind and jump in with him. You're given an opportunity to be liberated from all the mess, to just now begin to walk it out with the living God. O kiara sa, o kiara sara bote, o kiara sara botere, munde resita. You know, when I'm ministering, I look around at people, and I'm looking for the glorious liberty of the sons of God to be manifested in everybody. And then what happens if I don't see the glorious liberty of the Son, Christ Jesus, the wonderful work of the new man, the wonderful flow of the Holy Ghost being manifested in you, then the next thing I'm doing is saying, Lord, what must I do? What can I do to break them out of the stronghold of the powers of darkness or of self-interest that's keeping them from having what you freely gave? Well, you paid such a high price for us to have. It's just like I want 100% of the people to be healed. I don't want anybody to remain sick. Well, more than that, I want 100% of the people to be filled with heaven. Are you gonna blame me for wanting you to be filled with heaven? What I've got to learn to do and what I'm learning to do is not just be distracted with you at the expense of the other 99 not getting fed, not being able to move on with God because I'm so locked in on the fact that you're all bogged down. And I want to bring everybody along and get everybody going. It's almost like being willing to say, come on, camp, we're moving on in to this realm of glory. I know so-and-so's sitting down, but they won't get up. I mean, you know, and you think, well, should we leave them out here? Well, look, if we don't, we're all going to have to stay out here. Can you hear me? Yes. Now, most of us would say, look, let's just put ourselves in that situation. Let's go for the full thing, okay? We in the desert, okay? It's a hot, burning hot sun by day, right? And it's cold, and the animals are prowling around by night, and they hungry. And you sitting down, and we all going to decide just to leave you. Okay, Ann, sorry, we're just leaving you. And then what is the rest of the people going to be saying? Pastor, how can you do that? Are we just going to leave her? If we just leave her out here, she's probably going to die. And so then we all say, yeah, that's true. So we just all kind of hover around her. And we say, get up. What happens is if everybody with one heart, with one mind, begins to minister to her about, look, let's go ahead and go on. What's going to happen? She's going to get up. No, I just can't believe he expects you to get up. Are you okay? Are you going to be all right? He's expecting you to get up. And then we're now divided. And we have no idea what we're doing, that we're actually empowering people to keep us from moving forward in God. I pray that you can begin to see things for what they really are, that you'll begin to define your life on the basis of what God has revealed instead of what you feel. You begin to define your life and your purpose on what Father has willed instead of what you've willed. And then you begin out of that, the next thing is you begin to define everybody else's life on the basis of what Father has revealed and what Father has willed. And now you begin to see, wait a minute, you have a capacity to be something far more than you can ever make yourself or acquire or attain through human efforts. All you got to do is with total abandonment, let go of all the stuff you've been holding on to and say, oh God, I thank you that I've been liberated now to go ahead and live fully for you. I'm going to take the risk of saying goodbye to that which everybody else holds on to which everybody else boasts in, and say, I'm throwing it all to the wind. I'm risking everything for him. I've been liberated now to live in a heavenly life, the life of Christ. When Father sees that, he baptizes you. When Father sees that obedience, he empowers you. We have to learn how to take up the shield of faith to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And you know, people have just reduced it to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And that's important because you're going to have to get over that first, because a lot of folks haven't been willing to go on with God. He showed them, he teaches them, he speaks to them about the pride of life. You know what reveals the pride of life more than anything else? Your unwillingness to walk in humility and brokenness. Every place that you're not willing to take upon yourself his divine nature of meekness and lowliness. Every place of that, all it does, that's where the pride of life is revealed. The pride of life can't be revealed outside that contrast. It's the light that shows a difference between that and the darkness. Why live in the chaos of that which Satan has produced when Father has brought us over into his glorious light? People, there is a new heaven and a new earth that's about to appear. People, listen to me. You're distracted with so many things, but Christ Jesus is about to appear. You understand me now. God's about to come and take his power and reign here now. There's not a place in time for you to live greater, to shine brighter than right here in this life, as we are opposing the powers of darkness for which Jesus Christ was manifest and destroyed. We don't understand the press of all that is in this world, the spirit of the age, and the prince of the power of the atmosphere that tries to neutralize us and even assimilate us. Our minds are quickly changed by popular opinion. We have no idea that it's actually the mind of the satanic realm, the influence of the atmosphere. Takin shipaili. Ermamusiata. You get serious with God, he's going to get serious with you. You get after God, he's going to get after you. Listen to me. You begin to pursue heaven. Heaven is easily found. Father brought all his glory into this realm in which you and I now live, into this heart, into this life. We don't have to go far, as it were, to send up into heaven or go down into hell to bring him up, or up into heaven to bring him down. Where is he? Nigh you, near unto you, in your midst, in your heart, and in your mouth. Oh, Ramambade every day. When we left for Africa, Satan was threatening me over and again. I'm going to kill you. I will kill you. I will kill you in the airplane. I will kill you on the street. Just threatening. This is the way he does it. Because he knows what we carry. He knows who we are. That's how he persecutes us. Every turn, I'm going to kill you. And you know what my response is? I'm destroying you. Jesus, my response is, Jesus is manifested to destroy the works of the devil, and he's manifested in me. Hallelujah. Jesus abolished death and brought life and immortality to light, and he's in me. You know, just shut him down. I shut him down. I'm in charge, not you. You're under my feet. Did you get the memo, devil? I have authority over you. I have, in fact, all authority over you, because Christ Jesus has all authority over you, and he's in me and I'm in him. I have no life and no identity and no purpose and no value and no meaning outside of him. I don't even exist out of him. He that hath the Son hath life. The sonship, the Son of God, this blessed ministry of, oh, what manner of love the God, the Father, has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God, having been born of his seed, having been born of the Spirit, having been born of the Word, having been born of the water. My God, people, why is it that we're going to look for value and meaning in a world under the influence and domination of demon power and call it good? Or okay, why is it that we won't rise up against it and bind it as Christ Jesus showed us by example and gave us the authority to whatever we bind on earth? Why is it that we don't love him so much that we're willing to become members of his body? Members, yes, one of another. Why is it that we won't give our hearts over to fully loving him? Because when we do, we love those that are begotten of him. That's the way it works. Everybody who's having a problem with love, your problem isn't with the person around you. Your problem is with the Father God. And he's constantly showing us the state and condition of our heart. He's constantly showing us the state and condition of our spiritual position before him. And yet we'll self-justify and blame it on other people because we're trapped in a demonic world of comparisons. We're influenced in a demonic world of compromises and competition. Man, when you understand this, when you understand that I'm telling you by revelation from heaven these things, then you'll begin to notice how much competition you got in your life. Instead of making it a good thing that you go with, you will abhor it and recognize it's part of the pride of life. And you're feeding something, you're giving. It's not that you're feeding it. That's the wrong word. That's been misapplied. I mean, make sure I don't use the wrong semantics here. You're empowering it to dominate you. Because look, the will, God has given man the right and the will to choose what realm he will live in. Should you be and I be willing to make the living God, Christ Jesus, master, ruler, sovereign authority? We come under the influence and the glory of the reign of the King of Kings. And then we come under the domination of the Spirit of the living God, which has evidence, measurable evidence of love, divine love. I was with some people the other night, and they were just standing looking as this divine love and glory set into the place that we were in. And they were just standing there going, there's so much love here. I don't know if I've ever seen this much love. Yeah, it just goes with us. Many times we have to confront hate. We have to confront dimensions of hate because dimensions of hate are just feeling unwanted, feeling separate, distance. That's hate. What's what God calls it? It's coming under the influence of not the Holy Ghost. It can never be justified as the Holy Ghost or the fruits of the Holy Ghost. It's coming under the influence and allowing your members to be dominated by evil things. Oh, God would show us how to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Having been so endued with Him, so filled with Him, the lust of the flesh has no possibility. Sandy went to she still had the little bit of a, went from a big thing to a little pea-sized hernia, right? She goes to the doctor on Wednesday. The surgeon feels around and says, you don't have a hernia. There's nothing to operate on. Isn't that beautiful? He's the healer. But she had to be willing to hook up her faith with it. There has to be a willingness to check and see. There has to be a willingness to come back. Go after it again. Believe God. There has to be a willingness to cry out and say, Father, do this thing. I know that this is what you purposed. I'm not going to have it any other way. I don't want it any other way. There's got to be a willingness to go after Him and have a place to stand in confidence and certainty that this is what God has said. And you're now like a tree planted by the water. Your roots go down deep and you won't be moved. Men would try to overthrow the certainty of the Word today more than ever. That's all Satan can do, because Father has released it into the earth, as it were, to where that people have an unlimited opportunity. It's literally a saturation of the Word of God, if by no other means, the internet. So now all Satan can do is try to invalidate it and try to invalidate it on several different levels and say, well, it's not what was really originally written. How do you know? In fact, models of statistics show us that it absolutely is what was written. There's ways to do that, and I've been involved in some of those projects. Then men would come along with their traditions and with their ideas and say, well, this and that's enough for today. Men would come along with their counsel and say, well, God, you know, we just got to submit ourselves to His way and His will, and obviously this is His way and His will. Men, but that kind of an idea, then sin is His way and His will, because it comes and takes over you, and you sit there so passive like that and just accept whatever wind it blows. Now, there's a place you're going to have to stand up knowing what God has purposed and say, it's not going to be any other way than what God said. And the more you grow in relationship with Him, and the more He can hold you responsible with things in the kingdom, He's going to hold you with a greater, higher responsibility to stand in that which looks like is absolutely impossible. And dare not stagger at His promises. Right now, you're just dealing, you know, with baby pool stuff. Huh? Oh, you surfing in the ankle-deep water. You got the board out and you floating around, but you know what? You're saying you're surfing, but it's ankle-deep water. Because Father's not going to allow you to be tested above what you're able. But He will empower you and strengthen you and bring you to a place and give you the ability to stand over here in the realm of His glory. Hallelujah. He had a champion in Job. He said, whatever you do, Job isn't going to change. You can't touch his life, though. He's mine. He's a provable champion. God don't need no champions no more. Jesus came and died and rose again. What Father's looking for right now is you and I being willing to fully live our lives in Him. Because there's no way that you can fully live your life in Him and accept the identity that He's given and accept the love that He's given and accept the relation that He's living and not be liberated. The love that He's given, forgive me, and not be totally freed and liberated to receive everything He has right now. And if not everything He has, at least a little thimbleful. Got a little thimbleful, rather. A little thimbleful will bring you up out of that chair and you'd be running around. We'll have to sit you down. I laid my hands on one older preacher. One time. And he's walking around prophesying to people. How many times have I laid my hands on you? Just think about that. Because it really is, it comes down to the will, and it comes down to what you're willing to believe about what God said about you. All I am is an instrument of God, a point, as it were, of where His glory flows out and ministers to you. What really, by and large, the anointing in my life, though it is a helper of your faith, it just goes that far as the helper of your faith. You're going to have to be willing to choose these things that God has made available to you and grab a hold of them and run with them. And I can prove it to you, because you're going to have as much of God sitting in this place as if you went and take the greatest preacher on the face of the earth and go sit in his place. You're going to have to deal with the same issues, you. Your will. And your softness to Him or your hardness to Him. Your yieldedness to Him or your resistance of Him. And probably what happens is, I've discovered it over and over again, the pastor's going to say same things to you that I said to you. You're going to go, wow, what they must have conferred. Yeah, they did. They heard from the same Holy Ghost. I mean, about the only way that you couldn't hear the same thing is you'd have to go to a church where the Holy Ghost wasn't there. Jesus says, truly, truly, with absolute certainty, I'm telling you exactly how it's going down in heaven. Verse 24. Except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Father is waiting for this precious fruit of the earth. I can look at James chapter 5 and verse 7, and I can recognize that the parousias of the Lord does not have to be locked down or just isolated to the one event in which Christ Jesus comes. I would be willing to say that you can understand James 5, 7, that concerning the Father is waiting for the precious fruit of the earth, the one that He's cultivating, the one that He has paid such a high price to be reproduced in you and me. That it doesn't have to just simply be only isolated to that event, because there's many times that He comes to us in His sovereign moves. He comes to us as the rain, as the early and the latter rain. Because that's what He says, I will come to you as the rain. You want to see that verse of Scripture real quick? Some of you are looking at me like, I never read that one. Go to Hosea. Just look with me quickly. Go to Hosea chapter 6. I want you to see this. Hosea chapter 6. Then shall we know if you follow on to know the Lord, whose going forth is prepared as the morning. Ooh, mama said, King, my lata padre. Hallelujah. His going forth, or prepared as the morning? What's that? His going forth is as the preparation of the morning. What does that look like? Every day. Every day. Eternal and perpetual rising of the sun by God's command and by God's divine order. And listen to this. He says to you, and He shall come unto you, and He shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and the former rain unto the earth. His comings. So when we recognize the sovereign movings of God, it's Hosea chapter 6, verse 3. the sovereign movings of God. We can look back and we can see this almost in the Welsh revival. People would almost like set their clocks, as it were, by it, or their calendars. Like every 40 years, it would be the sovereign moving of God. We can look back in the church history, and we can see where there were all of a sudden this great outpouring of God that swept the earth. What was going on? There was somebody, somewhere, a people that were cultivating what Father was cultivating. They were giving themselves over to desiring that which God has described in His Word to be in their life. If you look just back in 1906 at the Azusa Street Revival, you can see that wasn't just a prairie fire that just sprang up overnight. That was being cultivated for more than 30 years. You can see it of the things that were going down in the people's, the holiness movement's writings in the lives of the people, where their passions were at. They were desperate for the movings of God, for the movings of Pentecost, for the things that was seen in the glorious church in the book of Acts to be seen in them. There was this passion to cultivate this high ground where people were mocking them and saying that they were gone to extremes or whatever. They were passionately pursuing what God described in His Word, so that when He sovereignly moved and when He came, they were ready to move with Him. They were prepared to receive all that He had so that they could be the instruments of the advancement of the kingdom of God. There's a fruit that Father looked for in Israel as the representatives of His kingdom. And He said, I'm taking the kingdom from you. I'm going to give it to a nation that will bring forth the fruit of it. Father's looking for a fruit, and that fruit's described only in the life and person of Jesus. Jesus describes to us how He's going to reproduce His life in us. This is the revelation that Paul gets. Oh, He's going to reproduce His life in me. When it was revealed to me, when it was made known to me that He'd purposed to reveal His Son in me, that's what this new birth is all about, that His Son is now to be revealed in me, to be made manifest in my life. I conferred not with flesh and blood, but I isolated myself and separated myself for 3 years in Arabia, seeking Him. I've embraced fully. Such an unspeakable gift. To just yawn about such an unspeakable gift. To put it on the back burner. To make it some part of our life. Oh God, we're trying to fit you in to the schedule we're just booked out right now. So, God has placed a divine gift in this place. He's placed a divine opportunity upon this place. He in His love and His mercy named the place, prescribed a destiny for the place, put a revival fire here to change a nation. It's time that the people of this place get on the same page with the Father and start becoming a part of His husbandry, being laborers together with the Lord, cultivating what He's cultivating, beginning with your own life and then around you. Because listen, it's time we don't just stand here in the wilderness. When He says, listen, this is your inheritance. This is really what Paul was saying to the glorious church when he said that, I pray that your eyes would be open so you can understand His inheritance in you. He's reproduced a Son in you. That you can begin to see what is the exceeding greatness of His power that's been given you when He raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And then He interrupts Himself for a few sentences, but takes it back up by the time you get to chapter 2, verse 6, and describes that He's raised Him up to His own right hand in the heavenly realm, and you're together with Him there in that heavenly place. Far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named. Not only in this world, but in the world to come. People, when that becomes your passion, everything else goes on the back burner. Everything else becomes secondary. You quit living your own life. You know what? Let me just tell you something. You know what your problem is? You know yourself after the flesh. And it's time you stop. I'm talking to a couple of you people, and I'm pointing towards your direction. And I could point over in this direction too, but it's just the Spirit of the Lord just pointed out to me. I don't want to call a name. It's time you know yourself after the Spirit. Time you know yourself after Christ. Paul said we don't even know Christ to Jesus after the flesh anymore. We only know Him after the realms of the Spirit, who He really is. Hallelujah. Many people have never really had that day. You know what for me is Pentecost Day. I understand things a little bit broader than what your theological one-liners would describe. Look, baptism of the Holy Ghost not only brings to you and I the first initial evidence of Pentecost, of the utterance of tongues, but it gives to us a place of revelation where we know, because Jesus said, in that day, when the Holy Ghost comes to you, and he was talking about Pentecost very clearly, when the Holy Ghost comes to you, in that day, you will know the Father is in me, that I am in you, and that you are in me. And he says it that way in John 14, 17. That is radical. There are many people who say they have Pentecost, and they stepped into Pentecost. They don't even know that right here tonight. You didn't know that, because to know that is a radical change. And I want you to know it. I want you to have an encounter with God, because when that happens, you will not be sitting there anymore, stuck, looking like you, knowing yourself after the flesh, looking at all your problems, looking at all of your issues, looking at all of your shortcomings, itemizing them, characterizing them, color coding them, grouping them by hierarchy of impact. Waking up and checking that all of them are still there. Yeah, they're there. Know yourself after the Spirit. Who has God made you? He's made you in Christ Jesus. After the Spirit, you exist only in him. I do not know, and I do not preach myself. I don't know myself after that former life, after that former identity. And I mean, God made me very radical with this, in this place that he brought me. When I ultimately read Romans 8:9 and read, you are no longer in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And then I started saying that, and people are going, you've lost your mind. Mark, you've lost your mind. I mean, look around, man. Take notice. All I can see is Jesus. I'm sorry, I can't see what you're seeing. All I can see is heaven. All I can see is after the Spirit. I'm sorry, I can't see what you're seeing. You see after the flesh. You breathe after the flesh. Think after the flesh. Not me. I have the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit. I'm not thinking after men. I'm not looking things after men. That liberated me. It liberated me to have an unlimited relationship with the living God, to receive all that he's given. It liberated me to stop asking and start thinking. It liberated me from stop struggling and start receiving. Hallelujah. Because now it wasn't based on who I am. It wasn't based on my performance. It wasn't based on all my ideas and concepts and what all the things that people said about me. I wasn't going to allow philosophies and traditions of men to spoil and ruin what God freely gave me as a gift, what Father is passionate about reproducing. And so the Lord says this. Hallelujah. He cuts right to the chase. Look here, he cuts right to the chase. Here you go. Hello! Hello! Testing, 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me now? This is it. The love of one's own life. Never has anyone ever hated their own selves. They love themselves and nurture themselves. If any man, he that loveth his life shall lose it. The Lord has come and presented to us the heavenly life, the life of God. And he says to us, do you want this life? And what happens is we can easily, if we're not careful, just be so infatuated with ourselves that we love our own life, which is defined by our choices. Defined by our will, defined by what we purposed, by what we dreamed. Oh, could we start dreaming with God? Man, if we started dreaming with God, I've heard it over and over again where men have willed things. And out of their will, they say, it's going to be this way, and I'm going to have it because I willed it. And they built great empires because they willed it. What happens when God's people start getting passionate about willing God's things instead of sitting around all passive waiting for another day? Man, I tell you right now, I feel like drop kicking that chair. You know what I'm saying? I'll punt the thing across the room. I'm tired of it. This stuff has got to stop. Like, let's just get radical about this. It's stupid. What's wrong with us? Why are we so mentally ill? captivated by our own life, the love of our own life. How could we possibly be that out of touch with reality that we would see this glorious life of God, the life of the only begotten Son poured out for us, sown for us, that it might be reproduced in our lives, and still want to choose and love and hold on to the things that we want? How can it be? But it is. It's the struggle. This is the struggle. This is the real point of attack. He that loveth his life shall lose it. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto the God kind of life, eternal life. Remember this. I want you to remember, when you read eternal life, remember John personified eternal life. He said, "We beheld that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us." He personified eternal life to be Christ Jesus. There's no life outside of him. God created all things by him. God spoke to us by the prophets, spoke to the Father by the prophets, but in these last days has spoken to us by his Son, whom he's appointed heir of all things. By the way, we're co-inheritors with him. By whom also he made the worlds. John, that's what Paul said to the Hebrews in Hebrews chapter 1. John says in chapter 1, it was the Word that created all things, and there was nothing made except it was made by him. I want you to think about the personification of the eternal life, because the eternal life has appeared. Jesus is talking about how he's going to reproduce the eternal life, how he's going to reproduce the God kind of life, how he's going to reproduce his life, how he's going to come and fashion and shape us anew, just as Father reached down and fashioned and shaped from the fine dust of the earth Adam. So he comes now with this wonderful plan of redemption, with the washing of the water of regeneration. Talk about getting cleaned up. There's no former thing left if you've been regenerated. You have to get into a demonic lie to believe that anything of the former life still exists after having been so cleansed. Because he does. Listen, understand Paul's doctrine. He takes the washing of the water of regeneration and he puts it together alongside of, in reality, the washing of the blood of Jesus Christ. And he makes the being washed in the blood of Jesus Christ equivalent to being born again. Because that's how the new birth comes. It comes because Christ Jesus sowed his life. When he sowed his life, he brought forth the power to have it reproduced in everyone who would believe upon him, who would call upon him. Because by calling upon his name, there's a miracle in his name. The miracle in his name is that God comes and recreates us anew after his image and after his likeness. Oh. To grab a hold of this. I'll keep saying it until you hear it. I'll keep saying it until you believe it. I'll keep saying it until you jump up and start moving it. I'll keep saying it until suddenly the fire of God comes upon you and you go, wait a minute. There's billions of people living, millions falling off into hell every day, millions captivated by religion who's not heard this, and you're going to get up and you're going to begin to run with the Word of God and the fire of God. There's no sense in people just going out and supposedly preaching the Word of God and not moving in the ministry of Jesus Christ, which is signs, wonders, and miracles, the demonstration of the power of heaven being manifested through their life, because it's time now that this gospel of the kingdom be preached. And you're going to have to lose your life to do it. You can't hold on to your life. Hold on to God's life, because something's going to give. Something's got to give. Something's got to give. Something's got to give. I tell you, Ann and I just like, you know, every time we go someplace, and every time we go someplace, the power of heaven falls on people. And we go, Lord, we're so needed out here. We're so needed. People are just desperate. I'm always overwhelmed. People just stand there and look at me and say, we've never seen anything like this. We've never felt anything like this. People who've been sick and diseased for many, many years in pain, God instantly totally heals them. Well, why isn't this a flow going on in the meeting? Because Satan will fight against you and your church. People will come in with their determination to have their way and have their will and try to shut the whole thing down and run interference with God. And you know how much I'm going to allow that? No. You know how much I accommodate that? I have a great compassion for people because I have the compassion of Jesus. But I have zero tolerance for rebellion against His will. Zero tolerance. And that's why there's the flow. That's why there's the flow of the Holy Ghost here in the place. Hallelujah. That's why you're in a good soil to grow. And sure, there's no reason you can't just... God gave us the expedited program, not the protracted one. The plan in 3 years, they came into the glory of heaven. I mean, my goodness, baptism with the Holy Ghost, you saw what went down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Come on now. Come on now, people. Come on now. You need to start setting things up in your life to be able to begin to make room for the provision of heaven to flow through you. And Father, the things that Father described to take place happen through your life. Listen, if you're going to relegate yourself to supporting me, get with the program. And let's get to flowing in this greater works now, right here in this place. Huh? Get with the program. Get to fasting and praying if you identify that what God's called you to do is support me, get to fasting and praying then. And get yourself a breakthrough. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I don't need financial support. But what I do need is spiritual support to go and move forward into the will of God, the dimensions of God, to see the full-blown manifestation of all that Christ Jesus described when he described what His glorious church looks like. Listen, I'm okay with people who don't understand Ephesians, the glorious church. I'm not okay with people who say they understand it and don't do it. You understand me? So what I do is this. I choose to believe that when people aren't functioning with the glorious church as the Lord described it, they don't understand it. Because I'm not going to choose to believe that you have a satanic assignment against the church. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what it would be. That's the default. You satanic assignment against the church. Unwilling to stubbornly defying what God has purposed to do. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And this is exactly why, you know, this was exactly why this place is different. Some of you were raised in rebellious homes, especially when you were raised in rebellious Christian homes. You were modeled with the wrong things. And you tell me that that isn't a spiritual stronghold and a spiritual influence? I'm telling you, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm telling you, I can see it on you. I'm telling you, much of what I preach is to break it off of you. I'm telling you, I'm in your face about this for something far bigger than just your own interest. I'm in this because of what Father has willed to do in glorifying His Son. And His Son is glorified in the midst of the church. His manifest presence upon the earth. I'm telling you, God, we are His building. In other words, He takes and He produces out of the living stone, Christ Jesus. He produces living stones so that we may be built and fashioned by the Holy Ghost together up and be built up into a spiritual house where all the glory of heaven may be made manifest in the earth. This is revival. This is a revival. This isn't an awakening. Awakening belongs to the lost. Revival belongs to the church. Then there can't be any revival until there's a turning back to God. A turning back to God is a longing after looking at what God said, looking at the inheritance that He's given, and now saying, I don't want to live without this another day. Huh? I don't want to live another day in Babylon. I don't want to live another day as an outcast. I want to live another day under the yoke of bondage. I don't want to live another day oppressed. And oppression comes in evidence in many forms where people can't say no to pornography and demonic things and lust of the flesh and lust of the eye and iniquities that belong to criticism and suspicions and backbiting and all the rest of the mess that goes down. You listening to me? Where all of a sudden we at war against these things. And we understand how to effectively wage a good warfare. Because we're empowered to be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of His might. Not empowered, not touching the heaven, not touching heaven, not empowered. Not feeling the flow of the Holy Ghost, not empowered. Somebody said, what is it going to take for me to feel the flow of the Holy Ghost? You have to start worshiping God for who He is instead of who you are. Come on now. I'm going to tell you right now, God the Holy Ghost pronounced to you a liberating word tonight. Worship God for who He is, not for who you are. Don't worship God based on how you feel. Worship God for who He is. You'll feel different. I guarantee you. It won't take long. You start worshiping God. Then all of a sudden, you start living to worship. You start living to praise. Ooh, my, 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 my. Ain't nothing. You get so filled up, nothing can captivate your interest. The Lord Jesus goes on to say, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servant be. I'm right where Jesus is tonight. I'm right where He is. He's here with me. I'm in Him. I've had the event. He says, if any man serve me, my Father will honor him. The honor of the Father, Jesus has already described what the honor of the Father is. You ask what you will. Father, he talks about His Father's honor towards Him being made manifest and Him being asked able to ask the Father, and it's done. Understanding that John 15:16 describes to us this kind of fruit. Jesus talked about the fruit of inheritance. He said, you didn't bring forth the fruits to Israel. Matthew 21:43. I'm going to take it from the kingdom from you then. You didn't bring forth the fruits of the kingdom. I'm going to take it from you, and I'm going to give the kingdom to another nation to bring forth the fruit. What is the fruit? Him dwelling in our midst. His glory being seen in our midst. Being seen as the people of God. Living out the life of obedient. The life of as the people of God, being the head, not the tail. Amen. Being so blessed by God that we placed in a position of influence to touch all the nations of the earth. Yeah, I know that we fast approaching the moment of the last day when we'll be hated by all nations. I know we're approaching that moment, the finality of the last day, where men will be lovers of pleasure, lovers of their own self more than lovers of God. I'll never forget a resounding word I heard 2 months ago. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. I was just up on the platform. And it was as though I heard an audible voice. My people love pleasures more than they love me. I'm like, you talk about getting your sermon changed. I had a very nicely defined sermon. And now I hear this as it were audible voice. My people love pleasures more than they love me. And I'm going to tell you right now, my finger didn't come out and start pointing at you. I turned to Father. I said, no, Lord, I don't love pleasures more than you. Father, forgive me. Lord, is there any place in my life that I love pleasures more than I love you? People run to sin, they run to iniquity, they run to things, comforts in this life that only the system of this world can give you, instead of those comforts that only He can give. This is all about choices of our life versus His life. Father wants to honor us. There's a fruit that He's cultivating in our lives. There's a fruit that He gave to cultivate. And we've got to be careful, because there are things that will choke out the seed that He's planted, that He's cultivated. There's things that will choke out this tree of righteousness that He has cultivated and raised up. And it's the cares of this life. You need to define those things for yourself. I believe that if God's people would just get honest with the Lord and just let the floodlights of heaven shine upon them as they're just caught away in glory, not caught away in their own mental whatever. Mind games with God. Mental ascent. And then begin to allow God to show you by the Spirit what is the self. Because the Lord says, you must deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. He's given us an understanding of what it is He's purposed for us to do, the way in which we need to walk if we're to inherit all the things that He's blessed us with. then people need to be able to, in that context, look at and just say, Lord, am I preoccupied with the cares of this life? Cares of this life gonna keep you at home. Cares of this life gonna make you complain and murmur. It's gonna cause you to be fearful and intimidated, living under the spirit and reign of terror. We're not supposed to. God didn't give us a spirit of bondage to fear. You know you're in bondage if you're allowing fear in your life. Fear produces intimidation of all sorts and types. Father's sent forth the spirit of Son to our hearts, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, which is absolutely the opposite to living under the yoke of fear. To just say, Lord, if I allowed these cares of this life to influence me, to grab a hold of my passions, my affections, my vision, my dream, have I allowed the deceitfulness of riches? Maybe you haven't allowed the deceitfulness of riches. Maybe because I don't see anybody in here very rich. Now, if we compared you to Zambians who are living in thatch huts that are leaning with dirt floors, I'm like, how on earth could they continue to live like this? There's wood right there. It's good hardwood. Cut it down. Build yourself a proper house. There's concrete. It doesn't cost that much. Put in a proper floor. And if you can't get concrete, just do a wood floor. We lived on those for hundreds of years. But get off the dirt, man. It's like no passion for any kind of change. No direction. I'm like, how much of the church lives this way? There is a heavenly vision that God has given him. You know, it's half services is should be in most contexts coming to a close, and I've just given the introduction to lay the foundation and talk about what it is that I want to talk about. The Father has given us a heavenly vision, has given us a dream. We've dreamed a dream. One that the Lord has dreamt. And one that would be fulfilled if we would honor it. I mean, Joseph dreamed a dream from heaven, and it defined who his life, what his life was going to look like in many contexts. And ultimately, it was revealed in such majesty and glory. Father's dreamed a dream for us, and he's given us out of that dream, as it were, a declaration of the reality of our existence, of who we are supposed to be, a heavenly vision of what we're supposed to be doing. It should be defining our life. And within the context of that is that right now the kingdom of God is already here. The King of Kings is already here. Yes, the kingdom of God is coming, but we're already a part of the kingdom of God. And Paul described it when he said in Colossians 1:13, we've been delivered from the power of darkness and translated over into the kingdom of the dear Son. And a heavenly vision and our purpose should be, we have this authority to turn people from Satan to God. Then why is it that we would be willing to live with something else? Why is it that we're willing to live an earthly life when God has called us to a heavenly one? Why is it that we're willing to accommodate all these things and believe all these things that say no, that we cannot do that, when God said, yes, I've empowered you to do it? When he said, I've given you the power and the authority to turn people from darkness to light, to where that we can have that kind of an anointing, that kind of manifest presence, to where we go, Christ Jesus is going. Huh? It's when we walk into the room, Christ Jesus walks into the room. Oh, mama, you talk about boldness, you talk about confidence, you talk about no need to talk about the weather and what new shoes you bought. Huh? And the remodel of your kitchen. Oh, we just remodeled our kitchen and we got... Are you kidding me? You want to talk about that? That's nothing but nervous jitters, and a manifestation of your intimidation. You're not been emboldened with the life of God yet. You're still holding on to your own line. If you let go of that life, you'll be liberated from a prison. Hallelujah. Be liberated to live out a glorious life. Papa's put a wellspring. Hallelujah. There's this water and there's that water. Hallelujah. As long as your life consists and rotates around this water that you draw from the well, you're always going to be thirsty. But if you come to that water, the water that he has to give, a different kind of water, you never thirst again. To be emboldened with his life. Oh, Masikia Kadamakia too. These things we want you to minister to yourself, preach to yourself in the morning. We want you to patiently minister these things to your household until your household begins to hear the word of God. To your family, to your friends around you, to the people that work with you and that work for you. Huh. Then watch what God will do. He'll take you, and as you begin to take, as you do these things, you'll properly take your place in the church. Because the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to everybody in the church. God didn't give the spirit of intimidation to everybody in the church. God didn't give the spirit of fear. Well, I'm just not certain. I'm afraid that I might move out and it'll be a disruption. Yeah, you're under the fear. In bondage to fear. Father wants to give you the glorious liberty and embolden you. And a confidence in him. And a certainty of understanding the movings of the spirit. You know, the Lord spoke to me the other day. He spoke something radically to me. Here's what I was doing. I was saying, talking about how the wind blows where it wills and no man knows where it comes or where it goes. So are those that are born of the Spirit. Huh? So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. And I started to say, I was starting to say something about the movings of the Holy Ghost being that way. And the Spirit of the Lord said, no, the movings of my movings are not foreign to you. They're not as the wind. You know who I am. You know where I am. You know how I move because I'm with you and in you. You're not like the world that does not understand how it goes, how I move, where I come from, and where I'm going. Well, you are those who know where I'm coming from and where I'm going. You are those who have my mind. I'm like, Father, forgive me for being stupid for so long. Forgive me. I am so sorry. These things only come out of relationship. They come because we lay hold upon them. God brings us in and makes us a part of everything that he has. He doesn't leave us on the outside. He doesn't sit around the table and talk about how that we all around the table, how we got it. And poor, Leslie, she's out there. She don't know nothing. He invites us all around the table and empowers every one of us, no matter who we are, with everything that he has. And some people are just bold enough and just willing enough to believe it all the way, who are not been beaten down by man every day of their life. And even if you've been beaten down by man every day of your life, God will deliver you from that oppression. You've been beaten down by man and criticized and ruined with the lobotomy of humanity. He raised you up from the dead, make you alive together with him. By grace are you saved. By grace are you delivered. To where all of a sudden you rise up with the Son, Christ Jesus. Say, I no longer live, it's Christ who lives within me. Father has revealed his Son in me. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. What is a new creation? Christ Jesus. He died that he might reproduce his life in us. Sonship of Christ Jesus, the sonship. In that day, you should know that the Father is in me. That I am in you and that you are in me. In that day. I'm going to have that day every day. Ha, bo so cold, my name. Ha, ha, I'm going to be reminded. I'm going to be reminded. You know, if you walk around in this life and you listen to everything that is coming at you, from the cares of this life, from just an everyday natural existence. I mean, you'll end up believing everything that the devil believes. Or rather, you'll end up believing everything that religion believes. I have to go to the Word of God and get my mind right every day. Hallelujah. I've got to go to the Word of God and get my mind washed every day. Because there's all these things trying to impose itself upon me. Hallelujah. I've got to go to this place and drink of this water that Christ Jesus is supplying from the realms of the Holy Ghost, and thereby myself now being filled with the Spirit. And let me just tell you this. You give yourself to being filled with the Spirit, and this is what's going to happen. There will be more of a continual filling. If you just go whole day, you don't care. You're just like, you wide open, doing whatever you got. I got all this stuff to get done. I can't believe I got such an incredible workload. Everybody leave me alone. That's called the cares of this life. You don't have time to get filled with the Spirit. That's called the cares of this life. The fruit the Father's cultivating is not going to be reproduced in you. It's not going to be seen in you. You not labors together with the Lord of his husbandry and of his building. I'm labors together with the Lord. I'm in his vineyard working right alongside of him to cultivate the fruit that he's purposed to have. And that's the life of Jesus Christ being revealed in you and me. The way it was revealed not only 2,000 years ago, but the way it is revealed now. Father put a fiery word in my mouth, said, how can you have the message of the earthly ministry of Jesus without the message of his heavenly one? How can you have the message of just his crucifixion and his resurrection without having the message of his heavenly baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire? How can you say that you're part of his husbandry, that you're laboring together with him, when you're going to hold back half of that which God is doing? In fact, his heavenly ministry is far greater than his earthly one. Come on now, people. God the Father wants you to grab a hold of these things and just have them. To say they're yours and just begin to flow and function in them. Don't be saying they're yours and they're nothing happening. Don't be saying they're yours and then you go ahead and live your own life. It's like people walking around saying, I'm the righteousness of God by this smoking dope and drinking alcohol. Oh, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus while they're sleeping around. Oh, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus when every kind of sin and iniquity is going on in their life. That's stupidity, man. Not the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You're an idiot. Verifiably an idiot. Just totally twisting the word of God. That's people walk around saying, oh, I have all the things that Father has empowered me to have. I've received them now. And you're not functioning, flowing in them, man. You find a place to stand before him. You give yourself to the manifest presence of God, and it will get stronger and stronger in your life. You determine in your life that I'm going to be filled with the Spirit. I'm not going to live my own life. God, the Holy Ghost, brings to us the life of Jesus Christ, and it happens because we're willing to yield with him. Yes, we've been born of the Spirit. Yes, the Spirit of the Son is on the inside of us. Yes, we're a new creation. But the reality of it is we've got to allow God the Holy Ghost to have liberty within our life to express this life of God. Because all the other things around us would try to drown it out, try to put it out, try to make it of none effect, try to make it as though it doesn't even exist, and impose upon you an earthly life that is no different from anyone else's earthly life. We saw this guy up at the MTC in Oregon, and he's just so happy and jovial, and we all thought, he's the UPS guy, UPS guy. We thought, Greg. We thought, he's got to know the Lord. He's got to be full of the Spirit. To find out he's not, he doesn't know the Lord. But he so acts like a person full of the Spirit, we thought he must be full of the Spirit. And I started thinking, wouldn't it be wonderful if people that were full of the Spirit acted like him? We're the ones supposed to be full of joy unspeakable. Huh? But what's happening is this. We the targets of Satan. Satan targets us to harass us, to steal from us, like he does no other one else. And we don't know how to be filled with the Spirit and be empowered with God to have the strength of the Lord and the power of his might to take unto ourselves the whole armor of God, to be able to stand against all that Satan is doing. Because I'm telling you right now, this is really the context of what the struggle is about. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places. What is this about? It is about the life of Jesus Christ being revealed through you and me. That's what it's about. It's about his Son being revealed in you and me. It's about the authority that has been given to us, the inheritance that has been given to us, the heirship that has been given to us. Sonship means heirs of God and co-inheritors with Christ Jesus, whom Father has made heir of all things, by whom also he made the world. Come on, listen to me. Listen to me. This is the battle. Now all these things are trying to impose stuff upon us. The world system that we've accommodated and called it godly, ain't nothing godly about it. Oh, you going off to your job making money for yourself to live in a big old house or whatever, whatever it is, or a little house, either one. You know what I'm saying? There's people just upset and just concerned about their little old house. As the other people are about their big house. Both of them, my goodness, are just, you know, cut above a dump. Yeah, when it compares to the glory of heaven, it's a cut above a dump. How are you listening to me? I'm telling you right now. Hey, listen to me. We were just in Dubai, and everything is opulent. There's a 7-star hotel there. Everything is opulent, trimmed in gold. It's opulent. Everything is just marble and beautiful and just done to a place that I'm going to guarantee right now. You go into that, and you look at your place, and you go, we need to remodel bad. This place is a, huh? But I'm just taking another level. Just step over in a far more than another level, another realm. The glory. Ooh, the glory. The glory. The glory. The foundations of that place. Look at the foundations of that place. The glory. The beauty, the splendor of it. The splendor of the amethyst stone. The splendor of the emerald. All these various different beautiful things, crystal clear and transparent and beautiful in appearance and incorruptible. They don't rust. They don't gather mold and corruption. Just trying to describe to us such a fine and excellent realm of divine power and glory that we've been called into these spiritual riches of purity and holiness, holiness being defined by the manifest presence of God in our life. I pray that you lay hold on eternal life. I pray that you'll grab a hold of it and not let it go. I pray that you'll receive this inheritance, because you can read in Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4 that they didn't enter in. God loved them. God called them. They were all saying how much they loved the Lord. Amen. Oh, just love God so much. Oh, the Lord knows. Well, if you love him, why are you acting the way you're acting? If you love him so much, why don't you honor him? I'm not going with love that doesn't have honor in it. I'm not going with love that doesn't have honor. Oh, I love him so much. Well, then why won't you lay down your life for him? Why is it that you hold on to yourself and you all want us to sympathize with you? See, now you know what this is? I don't bring this out on the... I don't... When I'm out... I don't, like where I was just at, and then go out to different churches and minister in different contexts, especially the lost, I don't bring this out. But when I'm trying to deal with people in the context of pastoring in a church where Father wants the glory of all his majesty to be revealed, I must start pointing out the stuff that's stopping the power and the glory of God from being revealed. And there's no better way for me to do it. Somebody said, why won't you just take them into a room, take them offline and talk to them about it? Because there's not a strong enough, there's not a strong as an anointing as there is now to deal with it. So you can, is a help you resolve yourself to do what's right. Did you know that you have a treasure on the inside of you? Did you know that when you're born again, God puts a treasure on the inside of you? It's a treasure. And it truly is a treasure of unlimited riches. It's more than the mother load. It's the father load. So that the excellency of the glory and the power may be of him. What? excellency of a manifest glory and power is here available on the inside of me. Did you know, in the context of all of His fullness being revealed in your life, that He is able to do super abundantly above all that we could think or ask? And of course, when we talk about that context, the context being filled with all of His fullness, that is more than we could think or ask. He is able to do super abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to a power, the power that is inside of you. Everybody's looking upwards or outwards or whatever, trying to bring them down or trying to bring them up. He says, no. This faith, this realm of divine glory, it's in you. Where are you going to be willing now to stand against all the assaults, all of the lies, all of the attacks? And the Lord describes them as fiery darts from the wicked one that are quenched simply because you're willing to stand in this place of faith, the faith of God. You know what the faith of God is? The life of Jesus. That's the faith of God. It's the power and the life of Christ Jesus. I no longer live this life after the flesh, but after the faith of the Son of God who died and gave Himself for me. I want to close tonight with one passage of Scripture here. I want you to grab a hold of this. I really didn't go where I thought I was going to be able to go with respect to functioning in the sealed of faith, but the bottom line of it is you must understand, if you're not even willing to address that what Father wants most of all, the fruit that He demands, is the life of Jesus Christ being made manifested through us. And it's not something that you've got to earn or try to have. It's just something that you just allow to exist, because when you were born again, He formed His Son in you. He formed His Son in you. Christ Jesus was reproduced in you. In that day, you know that He's in you and you're in Him. Wow. Wow. I can understand how the Lord would be willing to be a part of a plan where He would say, I'm in you. In other words, I'm the source of your power and of your strength and of divine ability and of a changed life. I can get that. I can wrap my heart around that and praise God for that. But I can't even get how He would say, and I'm in Him. There's so much oneness. There's so much oneness. There's so much oneness. That's so much oneness. That's so much. So much. Grace, power, authority, divine ability. You're never going to function in these works and greater works until you believe it, because this is the divine authority of it. It's the source of it. Some of the simplest people that have ever lived, some of the most uneducated people, some of the people who had nothing else to live for or live by, they got it. Because they weren't so stuck with all the other forces of hell that they have accommodated as friends. Forces of hell that they've made friends, companions, assets. No, they're enemies. If there's anything that you can begin to understand in that context, of being weak, so that He can be strong, no longer trusting in your own self or looking to your own self. It's not so much that you defame yourself or your existence. It's rather that you step up into a whole other realm of living, because a revelation of Jesus Christ has come to you. And in view of Him, all that you've ever been is living in the pig pen. Well, and of course, you know, Paul, he made it a little uglier than that. He brought the poop word out. And he's a great example of someone who's far more educated than anyone else. Had far more reason to believe in himself and trust in himself, having been trained by the very best expert in the way of God. He's the example of the most religious of all people. He's the example of the person who could be viewed as filled of self-worth, self-importance. And God shows his grace there so that all the spectrum of men, from a Thomas to a Paul, from a Peter, from a fisherman to a Paul, could be viewed by all humanity so that we might see. We're on a leveling floor here. No matter who you are, it's about losing your life so that you might live his. And then by his grace, he then makes that impossible event a miracle of immediate reality when he says, if any man be in Christ Jesus, it's all brand new. Everything old has ceased to exist. What's left for me to do, Lord? Believe. What's left for me to do, Lord? Participate. Move with me. Do you give an open door to sin because you believe it's got to happen in your life more or less every day? It's going to. If you have an open door to sickness and disease and you're not radically opposed to it and against it, then it's going to overwhelm you. It's going to take you. But if you fully embrace this ministry of Jesus Christ, who was manifested to destroy the works of darkness, if we begin to fully embrace this life of Jesus, who is anointed with power and the Holy Ghost, whom God anointed with power and the Holy Ghost, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed with the devil, for God was with him, to take up this mantle, to take up this life, to be unwilling to have any other existence, to be unwilling to allow anything in your life to somehow dominate over you, to where that this isn't the ongoing flow. If you've got something going on in your life that shuts down this flow of heaven, stop it. Oh, my job demands my full undivided attention. But you don't have a very difficult job, do you?
Jesus.
I can't be flowing in the Holy Ghost while I'm at work. What do you define flowing in the Holy Ghost then? What on earth have you dichotomized your life down to? Oh God, in Jesus' name, these things, let them be no longer in existence in men's thinking, their mind. Now tonight we've just purposed that everybody in this place gets touched by the realms of heaven. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven right now. Let the Spirit of the Lord come upon you and overwhelm you. Hallelujah. Let the manifestation of the Spirit begin to function to your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Why don't you just stand with me, everybody? Stand with me. I see Kyrgyzstan's here tonight. Right? Kyrgyzstan. Hallelujah. We believe in God for great things in Kyrgyzstan. Hallelujah. Makara siti dananeyashi. Hananangane. A promosai. A promosito ya. A promosite adanesht. I just want everybody to come forward. Amen. Just come on up here. Really need to move the chairs out of the way so we got more room to get around. So you can go flying around. Just press on in up here. communion with the world will not convince you of what God has purposed for your life. Being caught up in your everyday existence and what you know about the things of God is not going to bring the flow of the Spirit and a revelation of the purposes of God for your life. And God purposed to manifest His Son in you. Something, an event that's already taken place if you've been born of the Spirit. And I'm looking at people here tonight that have been born of the Spirit. Thus Christ Jesus is in you. The Son is in you. The seed of God's Word has produced within your life the planting of the Lord. The question is, are you going to allow the fruit of God to be made manifest? I want to read this verse of Scripture. So honey, work your way up here with the Bible. And let me read the verse of Scripture while everybody's standing up here. The flow of the Holy Spirit, Lawrence, is going to become so rich in your life that you can have, and you'll see and understand that you have all nine gifts of the Spirit available to you. See, so many people are waiting for the events of God to happen in the future when they've already been taking place. God's already, these things of heaven already reside within your life. It's just that when you're so preoccupied with other things, there is no confidence and no boldness to move out and begin to give yourself to that which God is doing. I pray in the name of Jesus that you do not no longer know yourself after the flesh. I mean, then you could advance to knowing no one else after the flesh either, but right now, just don't know yourself after the flesh. But begin to know yourself after the Spirit, what God created when He created you anew in Christ Jesus. What God created, not when what He created when you were born of your mother and your father. Because that's what you've determined to know. Unfortunately, because you just didn't understand. But tonight we want you to determine to know what God created when He created you anew in Christ Jesus. And then you can begin to look around and others, once you begin to know yourself after the Spirit, you begin to look around at others and then know them after the Spirit too. But when you begin to, first and foremost, you begin to know yourself after the Spirit, you're not constantly looking on all the problems and all the issues and all the weaknesses and all the things that are not God's report about you, that you've never been able to take the Word of God and stand in it, because that's the shield of faith, the Word of God. That faith that comes by the Word of God, that faith that comes out of this love relationship with the Lord, causes you and I to be so fortified in Him that we don't believe what anybody else says. You try to tell me all you want. You try to tell me any bad thing about my wife that you want, and I'm going to tell you right now, you're a liar. And I'm not listening to you. And it'll be only by the grace of God that I don't smack you. And it needs to be that way in our lives concerning our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and who it is that we are now in Him and what He has made us. How He views us, what He's positioned us to be in Him by this new creation. What He's made us to be in Him. You're going to have to quit just listening to all the suggestions and the lies that men and devils have put upon you. And that's why I want to read this verse of Scripture to you. I want to read it to you because it's Spirit and life. See, when I open up the Bible, I open up the Word of life. I open up a power and authority that God has placed within our hands and given to us, where He Himself communicates His own heart and will, and it goes beyond any other thing that you can read. And that's why you read it over and again and over and again and over and again, and it's like you've never read it before. I'm reading the Bible through right now, Old Testament through in Hebrew, and I'm just stuck. I'm just like going, whoa. You're amazing, Father. You did what? You said what? You want what? You love me like that? Well, I'm gonna let your will then, Father. I'm gonna let your word have free course in my life. I'm going to be what you created me to be. You said it, and it is so. And God said, and it was so. You want a phrase? That's it. God said it, and it is so. As you have received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk in Him. What an empowerment. Rooted in Christ Jesus. I'm in Him and He's in me. Rooted in the new creation. Rooted in the new man. Rooted in a brand new identity. Rooted in the reality that old things have passed away, that the old man was crucified and destroyed, that everything is new, that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Rooted. In the reality that there is therefore no now, there is now therefore no condemnation. There's no shame. No need to go run and hide. There's no fear. It's been removed. Rooted. Rooted in what? Rooted in the reality that I'm living out the life of Jesus Christ, that He's in me and I'm in Him. That I no longer live, it's Christ who lives. That God, when He gave me this new birth, purposed and ordained that His only begotten Son would be revealed in me. Sonship, beloved. Oh, what manner of love. Oh, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. That we should be called the sons of God. As many as believe, He gave them the authority to be sons, fashioned, shaped in one identity with all our existence only in Christ Jesus. Built up, established in the faith. This is the faith. As you've been taught, abounding therein with a steadfast giving of thanks, with a continual giving of thanks, not a complaint, not a wondering why, not a wondering when, not worshiping God based upon how you feel about yourself, but how you feel about Him. Worshiping God for who He is, not for who you are. Oh, in Jesus' name, hear the word of the Lord tonight. Hear the free gift of His love and of His salvation. Take hold of this eternal life, lest it should slip. And then the Lord puts up the big giant beware sign. He puts up the big giant beware sign, and listen to this. Beware. And understand this is a living reality, something that you're faced with, a force that opposes you, a power that comes out against you. Beware lest you be spoiled by philosophy, by vain ideas and traditions of men, and the rudiments, the order of the world. What men say, you must be doing this if you're going to be a responsible citizen. If you're going to be a responsible person, you've got to be doing these things and those things, and you've got to have this and have that. Otherwise, you just don't fit in. God said, it'll spoil you. It'll ruin what I've done. It'll ruin you. You'll never be able to step in to the glory of the Son. For all these things, Paul ends with in this verse, are not after Christ. And then he says, for in Him dwells all of the fullness of the God, of the power of God bodily. And you are complete, fulfilled, finished. This was your purpose, your destiny. You were designed to be this, and you are complete. Who is the head over all principality and power. And Paul goes on to put the final blows to everything of a former identity, saying, you circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, the circumcision of Christ and the putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh, buried with him by baptism into his death. Wherein you also risen up together through the faith of the operation of God, who also raised Jesus from the dead. I was raised up by the same power that raised up Jesus. You raised up by the same power that raised up Jesus. Somebody said, where do you find the strength? Where do you find the encouragement? Right here. Just doing what I'm doing right here with you right now, I do every day. Because I have a relationship with him. I'm seeking first the kingdom of God. It's the most important thing. If you're going to have what God has purposed, then this is what you must do. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all that God's purpose will be yours. And all that you have need will be added to you. And it'd be greater than what Solomon had. How do you like that? You seek your own, you're going to have a little shack somewhere out in the back in the middle of the crowded downtown. With all spiders, roaches, and mice therewith. And now that's going to be your confidence. Oh, God. And all the time, because you hung on to your life, you missed out on the great adventure, the freedom to be liberated, to live the glorious life of Jesus Christ. People, you're at a point in time, you're having an opportunity now to, with total abandonment, throw your life away, just get rid of it, and now grab a hold of the life that Christ Jesus has given today. Go ahead. You don't really have much. You don't really have much to lose anyways. You don't really even have much to risk anyways. It's not like you're the rich man that's got to go sell billions of dollars and give it away to the poor. You're in a good spot. You're in a good spot. It's so much easier for you to do. I pray in Jesus' name you'll do it. Don't hold on to your own opinion. Don't live in self-justification and self-worth. When God has given you the privilege of seeking him, those that seek him shall find him. Those that seek him shall be rewarded by him. And now the reward will be the greatness of his glory and his manifest presence revealed unlimited, in an unlimited way. Tonight I'm going to lay hands on you and pray for you. Power of God's going to come upon you. And I'm believing that the Spirit of the Lord will strengthen you, every one of you. I'm believing, God, that the Spirit of the Lord will strengthen you not to allow things of this world to define you. Not to allow some educational training to define you. Some bad or even good experience to define you. Some vocation to define you. But tonight we pray in Jesus' name that you'll fully step over into the realms of the kingdom and begin to get so excited about how God has defined you and what he said about you. Hallelujah. 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 Woo! Woo! Hallelujah! Thank you for your glory! Thank you for your love! Thank you for this so great a salvation! Thank you, Father, for this abundant life! Thank you, Father, for this abundant life! Thank you for this life in Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let me tell you how you abound in it with thanksgiving. You abound in this with thanksgiving. Mine and Kishigal and I'm going to say. Nicole, lift your hands towards heaven. Father, we thank you that Nicole will worship you for who you are, not for who she is. She began to worship you for who you are. Let the glory flow right out of your belly now. Yep. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. 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 Long day. Late on us. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let that flow of heaven come busting out of you. Let that flow of heaven come busting out of you. Let that flow of heaven come busting up out of you. Let that flow of heaven come busting up out of you. Hallelujah. The other night we were holding people up who had never fallen down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're holding them up. Lift your hands towards heaven. Close your eyes. Shut in with God. In Jesus' name, from this day forward. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Satigirimasai. Father, I ask you to open up David's eyes that he may abhor sin. That he may abhor the pride of life. That he may abhor it. That he may abhor it. Abhor it. Father, I thank you for giving him the ability to see the things that would keep him from being able to receive and continually flow. Sikaranea. Sikaranea. Right now in Jesus' name, I break the strongholds of the enemy that would try to affix themselves to your life. To see the Son, Christ Jesus, to begin to recognize, to receive the Spirit of revelation, that you have the privilege and the grace to live out His life would cause you to not want to live any other life. To not see it would set you up to live another life, which is called the pride of life. Be filled. Built. 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 Filled. 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 Next day. The beauty and the splendor of His presence. Yeah, that's the glory of heaven. Hallelujah.
Out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost. Receive the Spirit of grace. Receive right now.
Mojea, Mojea Manea. Mosea Manea Sai. Monea Zabalatana.
The fire of the Holy Spirit, the fire, the presence, the wind of heaven, the glory of the sun. Saki Darropo Rinish.
Miana Nasheta.
Zatronasi. Zat revivalist. Fiery revivalist. Men and women who go everywhere preaching this word of life. Holding forth the word of life, Christ Jesus.
Karaman Jesse.
Lirapo. Lirapo. Lirapo surideesh.
Mananga dea. Mananga le shiparana nekaya.
In Jesus' name. By the power of the name of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Say, filled up.
Filled. 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 Rust.
Live in the gift. Live in the gift. Live. Live in the gift. Live. 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 Live in the gift. Live. Live in the gift of the Son. Live in the gift of the Son. Live. Rasai ribayalo. Lanabayo. Sayaravasi. Lasanake. Sayaravasi. Sikaya remain.
Nengeshi.
Ha ha. Masia Rabo.
Manane.
Manaya Shane. Manaya Salamos. La Sara Bisake. Libashev Rabom.
Ha ha. Manaya Shane and I.
The flow of heaven. The flow of the Spirit. The flow of the Son. My name is Ash. Sutri Sikaya. There, I'm going to say, the fish of prata. There, Bakoro Sopine. Pesironosi. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Basso taio, basso tepeke. Basso brave, basso taca. Sake kinakateo, sitaela mosoto. Kasayala sate nene.
Barasei, barasei, baraseia. Deia Shapane, Deia Shapanenea.
Vea Shapanosoto, Vera Shipokona, Deia Shipramare, Vea Shipramare, Vea Shipramaro, Primaro Seara, Primaro, Primare Rea, Primarava. Fiery anointing, fire! 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 Resete! Fire! Resete!
Si risarrebeia. Si arrabassa radaia. Mundaia la kishe karenea. Out of your belly. Out of your belly flows. Marrabarri minando lo sicuro susti.
Violate! Violate your word, oh God, like a fire shut up in the bones. Your word, Father, like a fire. I say,
Noreri, Norera Shiridar, Norera Shiridarumas, Norera Shiridarumas, Ikea Katan. She caraneke kenakete kienost. Serri mamanderist. Out of your belly. Out of your belly.
Out of your innermost being. Abounding therein with thanksgiving. Abounding, rooted, grounded, settled, established in the faith. Christ Jesus. Zorimana sekerimai. Alemane. 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 Alemane nanganane anamashia da mania da da makia da da mania tia da da mania sapania da da nieke. Nayana mania tia lo bosato ku misabayo to Jesus. Zoom. Zoom. Name. Zafri ve robo ribere manaya hasai lebeki so anyways terrebe costaia tarra batai lo monzai ma bravat gotus gotus itakrak dek sek mako. Sakatos to Terene, Sakatos to Taranosa, Batti Prataparopo, Batu Terameshi, Batu Romosikai, Batu Romosori.
Out of your belly flows rivers of the Holy Ghost. Out of your belly flows. Lift hands towards heaven. Thanksgiving. Happy, happy. Worship God for who He is. Just worship Him for who He is. The one who loves you so much. He gave His only begotten Son for you. Ha. Hallelujah. Mandeya shikaya no mondir seyri. Let praise come loud enough so somebody can hear something. Let the power of God be made manifest to your life in such a way that more people than yourself will be affected by what God's done in your life. Receive right now. 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 Fresh touch from heaven. 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 Father, would make heaven more real to you, more valid to you, more meaningful to you than anything that has happened in this earthly life and in this earthly realm. We watch all the time as people are constantly preoccupied in their prayers about God giving them something that is nothing more than earthly. about God doing something for them that is nothing more than humanly. Father says, why would you go seeking after those things that are purely for human interests, like food and clothing? The Lord says to us, yes, you have not because you ask not. And when you're asking things that can only be consumed within your own interest. When all the time Father would give to us those things that belong to a heavenly realm. Those things that would so fill us with all that we've ever had need of, all that we've ever truly wanted but never knew how to ask. So much so that we would find ourselves blessed on a level of coming in and going out continually blessed. So filled up, so supplied that we have need of nothing else, nor want anything. Then there, finding ourselves so filled up with all that Father has supplied in this life of Jesus, that everything else is provided as just overflow, benefit. Dakoki nakcheka. Koki nakcheka mokite. Koki nakcheka modenderasi. Koki nak blanje zebra. Koki nambate shibrane ishti.
Jesus. 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 Nande shikir ramanga de klista pro. Manande redeste. Birinane shikailamos.
Tonight, this meeting is about allowing God to take full control of your life. Allowing the lover of your soul to begin to more than just influence you. But to begin to live through you in a way you didn't even realize possible. Toko ginazeg dek lang jesu. Tonight, I'm laying hands on you in faith that you begin to walk in the mind of the Spirit, in the mind of Christ. No longer live after the reasonings of your own understanding. I'm believing God that you'll step out in a confidence and a boldness that Christ Jesus is so on the inside of you that if you lay your hands on the sick, they'll be healed. I'm believing tonight that you'll so believe that Christ Jesus is in you that when you ask, you know that you have those things that you've requested of the Father. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. The richness of heaven. The richness of heaven. The richness of heaven. The richness of heaven is yours. The richness of his presence. The richness of his life. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Korama maneseo. Koromo mondo sikinia. Korama mangelishi protosifrite. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for the richness of your presence. For the richness of it. You know, you can walk around singing, Lord, I am yours, and you are mine. I'm in you, and you're in me. You're the vine, and I'm the branch. Reveal your son in me. Just walk around, just talking to yourself concerning these things of how blessed you are that Father's included you. And if there's things that you need to repent for, just repent for them. If God shows or points things out in the meeting, and you can think, was that possibly me? Don't get upset because somebody's as though somebody's talking bad about you. Don't have a wounded or a hurt attitude or a spirit of offense. But just repent and say, Lord, I don't want that in my life. I'm sorry for behaving myself that way. I'm sorry for justifying myself when I would rather you be justified. Hallelujah. Huh? Bake konamokoteshi. Bake namokote. You know, I look around tonight and I see that for most people, it's just very small adjustments that need to be made in their life. Just very small adjustments. And then all the things of this divine life would so freely flow forth from you. You would be first partaker of the fruit. And then there would be plenty left over to give for everyone who has need. You would find this place of living in divine health, divine provision, divine protection. You'd find yourself all of a sudden becoming useful in the kingdom, in a greater dimension. All of a sudden, things of the spirit would be more important to you than the things of this earthly interest. Is there anyone in here tonight who believes that God's just going to give up on you after a couple of attempts? I promise you, He will not. Thank you, Jesus. I hear Jesus saying, come unto me, all you who weary and are heavy laden, burdened down, and I shall give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He says to us, come learn of me, for I am meek and lowly. Come understand the ways of God. Come understand this place of meekness with confidence. And this place of humility with boldness. Come learn this place of submission to the ways of God, the authorities of God. to where no longer do you rely on or count on your own insight and your own opinion. There are some, and the Lord even just caused me to aware of, there are people even that are watching by web right now. You just got an opinion about everything. I mean, you just understand everything in your own mind and thinking. God wants that to come to an end. He wants you to shut all that nonsense down. It's really nonsense. It's like a person who's hallucinating, you know. And they're just, you know, they're just saying all these things that they're seeing in a hallucination. It really is, but there are those who become boastful and they become, as it were, haughty even about the things that they think they know. And reality of it is it's keeping them from knowing the things that God knows. That Father has purposed to freely show us. You see, the Holy Spirit has come to take everything that belongs to the Father. And I hear it, I mean, talking to people who are leaders. There's people watching right now on the web.